to this Pentecost Sunday, which we're celebrating here at First Christian Church of Cuyahoga Falls, and with you in your home or wherever you may be, because God is everywhere, and so are we. And God has said that wherever two or more are gathered, the Spirit will be with us. Today, we celebrate that gift of the Holy Spirit in our midst. I invite you to take a moment and breathe in the fresh air, one of the simplest gifts of God that we have received and we so often take for granted. That we may become one in the Spirit as God has called us to be. Will you join with me in our call to worship? Noah built the ark before it began to rain. For 40 days and 40 nights it rained upon the earth. Moses led the people out of Egypt and toward the promised land. For 40 years, the people wandered in the wilderness. Jesus fasted and prayed. For 40 days and 40 nights, he was in the wilderness before being tempted. We come from a tradition of preparation, endurance, fasting, and prayer. For however long it takes, we will find ways to move forward in the promise of God's hope and love. Let us pray. Lord God, you have called your servants to ventures of which we cannot see the ending, by paths as yet untrodden, through perils unknown. Give us faith to go out with good courage, not knowing where we go, but only that your hand is leading us and your love supporting us. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. One of the greatest gifts that we share as the people of God is to be in prayer with and for one another. And so we take advantage of this opportunity anytime we gather together, whether it be face to face or virtually, such as this. This week we've had some joys. I know that Regan had a virtual dance recital. I know that Rachel and Tiffany closed on a new house that they are so excited about. I also know of friends who participated in protests around our state and around our country this week against the violence and the injustice that our siblings of color are facing each and every day. These are not new travesties, but they are being seen and shed new light upon. And so we join our hearts in prayer, just as we join our hands and our feet in service. We join in standing beside those who suffer. We join in all the ways that God weaves us together. And so though we are not able to share all of our joys and concerns, perhaps in this exact moment, know that we are still receiving those all week long through calls and texts and emails, whether to myself or to our church administrator, Sarah. You can share these. You can also be part of receiving those calls by being on our prayer chain. We're also developing a congregational care team to call and check in on one another. We're also excited to share some new opportunities that we are piecing together in order to be the church outside of and beyond Sunday morning worship. So, Rosemary Needham has agreed to start a segment for us called Something Good. And each week, in the middle of the week, she's gonna do a video on whatever has inspired her this week as something good and joyful that we can celebrate. We're also inviting you to share with us, whether it be in a picture or a video or a message to me that I can relay in Sunday mornings, something good that has happened in your life, or ways that you have been the church or seen the church at work in the world. Because we need reminders, not only that the church is open, but that the church is active in the world today. And so we're excited to share these opportunities and to see where they might lead us. Another fun opportunity coming up is for us to start doing some game nights and some other acts of service with surprises for neighbors and friends and members of the congregation. So please, please be attentive to to your Facebook and your emails, as we'll be sharing more details about those in the coming week. For now, I want to invite you to continue in an attitude of prayer as we join in our gathering song, Spirit. Verses 36 through 41. So let everyone in Israel know for certain that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, to be both Lord and Messiah. Peter's words pierced their hearts, and they said to him and to the other apostles, "Brothers, what should we do?" Peter replied, "Each of you must repent of your sins and turn to God and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. Then you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. This promise is to you, to your children, and to those far away, all who have been called by the Lord our God." Then Peter continued preaching for a long time, strongly urging all his listeners, "Save yourselves from this crooked generation." Those who believed what Peter said were baptized and added to the church that day, about 3,000 in all. Our second scripture passage comes from Genesis, selections from chapters 7 and 8. On the 600th year of Noah's life, in the second month, on the 17th day of the month, on that day the fountains of the great deep burst forth, and the windows of the heavens were opened. The rain fell on the earth for 40 days and 40 nights, and the waters swelled on the earth for 150 days. But God remembered Noah and all the animals that were with him in the ark, and God made a wind blow over the earth, and the waters subsided. The fountains of the deep and the windows of the heavens were closed. The rain from the heavens was restrained, and the waters gradually receded from the earth. At the end of 150 days, the waters had abated. And in the seventh month, on the 17th day of the month, the ark came to rest on the mountains of Ararat. The waters continued to abate until the 10th month. In the 10th month, on the first day of the month, the tops of the mountains appeared. At the end of 40 days, Noah opened the window of the ark that he had made and sent out the raven. And it went to and fro until the waters were dried up from the earth. Then he sent out the dove to see if the waters had subsided from the face of the ground, but the dove had no place to set its foot, and it returned to him to the ark, for the waters were still on the face of the whole earth. So he put out his hand and took it and brought it into the ark with him. He waited another 7 days. And again he sent the dove from the ark, and the dove came back to him in the evening, and there in its beak was a freshly plucked olive leaf. So Noah knew that the waters had subsided from the earth. Then he waited another 7 days and sent out the dove, and it did not return to him any more. In the 601st year, in the first month, on the first day of the month, the waters were dried up from the earth. And Noah removed the covering of the ark and looked and saw that the face of the ground was drying. In the second month, on the 27th day of the month, the earth was dry. Then God said to Noah, "Go out of the ark, you and your wife and your sons' wives with you. Bring out with you every living thing that is with you of all flesh, birds and animals, and every creeping thing that creeps on the earth, so that they may abound on the earth and be fruitful and multiply." Today I'm sharing with you a variation on a sermon from Reverend Al Dingen at Carthage Christian Church that he shared on the 40th day of our quarantine. Some of you may not know that that word quarantine actually has origins in the number 40, which we heard over and over again in our call to worship. Our scriptures today both acknowledge and celebrate two very different beginnings. The beginning of life again for all people, and the beginning of the church. The story in Genesis is a very familiar one. We have all sorts of songs and celebrations and VBS and Sunday school stories. It's all about rainbows and animals, and it gives us all the warm fuzzies of nostalgia and childhood. But perhaps in these days, we're hearing it a little differently. Most scholars agree that this is not a literal story, but probably it is an account of a great flood that happened in the ancient Near East a long, long time ago. These numbers that we hear over and over again throughout the Genesis passage seem big. Some are familiar, like the 40 days and 40 nights. Noah was 600 years old when the whole saga started. Did any part of that ring true with you? I would say that for many of us, the last couple of months felt like they took about 600 years. And imagine having been quarantined and it raining every single day. I know that the breaks in the weather have been a blessing for me. But it was still beyond those 40 days, another 150 days before the water abated. The 40 days were only the period in which it was raining and the flood was rising. And Noah and his family didn't leave the ark until much, much later than that. When Alan first shared his sermon, it was at the 40-day mark for all of us in our sheltered place. For us now, it's still been less than 70 days. Can you imagine being only halfway through? Noah had his kids with him, but they were old enough that they likely were able to keep themselves occupied, and he didn't have to do homeschooling.
40 days, so cooped up and raining the entire time. It's enough to drive anyone mad. All told, it's actually a year before they leave the ark. The waters start in his 600th year, in the second month, on the 17th day, and it's not till his 601st year, in the second month, on the 27th day, that they leave the ark. Is there still more rain ahead for us? Even when it stops, it doesn't mean that we can get out of the ark just yet. Just because it stops raining doesn't mean you can get out of the boat. You would drown. In fact, Noah sent out birds to see if it was safe for them. We want to get out of the ark, but we have to make sure that it is safe first. Perhaps the most beautiful part of this story is the way that the dove brings back the olive branch, something reassuring from the old world and the old ways. What is it that's reassuring for you? What is that thing that when you think of the way things used to be, when you were comfortable, when we were contented, when we were together, what is that thing that you would want as a sign that maybe, just maybe, the waters had started to go down just a little bit? Maybe it's time at Camp Christian. Maybe it's time in this sanctuary. Maybe it's an embrace from a friend. Whatever this olive branch is for you, this reminder of the old world, that is enough to tell us that it will be safe moving forward. But it should be noted that the world Noah emerges into is not the same one that he left. In fact, it should be. The very first thing Noah does when he exits the ark is to create a new covenant with God. We know it famously as the rainbow and how we got them even. But it is a sign that there is a new way and a new world. The world shouldn't just go back to the way it was before. If it goes back, then the flood is just a murderous flood. But if it goes forward, then it's a tragedy that transforms us to move in more faithful directions. Pentecost began in a time of fear. Life is different after the resurrection. Jesus is different. The disciples are different. It can't go back, and it shouldn't go back to the way that it was before. Why tie these two passages together? Because it is important that we remember that new life, new ways of life are possible. In Noah's case, the whole earth is flooded. Life all around him comes to an end. In Acts, many believe that Jesus is nearly dead and gone, and they cannot yet fathom what a new way, a new life, will look like. It seemed like an impossible situation. This seems like an impossible situation. And by this, I mean over 100,000 lives lost just in our nation to the coronavirus, with ever-escalating numbers of cases in our own county, stacked on top of violent protests against protective measures, and yet more protests over the wrongful deaths of so many of our siblings with black and brown bodies. Protests that have resulted, and in this moment, are resulting in tear gas and pepper spray and targeted arrests. And if you tell many of us that we have another 110 days like Noah did after the rain stopped. I'm doing this. Or that we have to wait an entire year before we can gather and respond in our familiar ways, it will seem impossible. But there is a chance to plan and work for a new kind of life. That's the point, that new life is possible. What do we see when we look out now? We see the waters of the flood. We see them rising and rising. We see the despair of people hiding in locked rooms. We see the desperation of people in the streets. And we see both the coronavirus and the virus of racism shining a light in the shadows of society. We have talked about some of these things before, but we are seeing it with new eyes in a new light. Sean Deja has written, "Black people face the highest percentage of deaths from COVID because medical access and other systems are structurally racist. This country is founded on racist economics, and we are all part of a racist economy. Asian Americans face hate crimes at skyrocketing rates because this nation tolerates and encourages the continuation of our long legacy of cultural racism that becomes most visible at crisis moments." If we think the solution is for people to be nicer, we are missing the fact that these systems of racism are destroying our communities. We share a crisis, but we are not all impacted by this crisis in the same way. We may have seen and discussed these things before, but many people across the country are seeing it for the first time, or acknowledging it for the first time. Is our response simply to say, this is the outcome of the epidemic? Or is this exactly the kind of society that we have been building for hundreds of years? What will our response be to these floodwaters? Will we want to double down on our systems of oppression in order to go back to the way things were before the flood? Or will we move forward in a new way? Going forward beyond closed doors, in impossible ways that we couldn't imagine before. But now, it just may seem possible. Jesus' invitation to new life comes with new experiences in a new world. Noah's life comes with a new way of living. Today, as we celebrate Pentecost and the birth of new church, and as we dare to envision what new life will look like for us and for all, I invite you to join me in the prayer shared by our General Minister and President, Reverend Teresa Ford Owens. I want a church that loves so courageously that we will stand up and insist that the killing of Black and Brown people must stop, and will work to remove those in office who fail to enact laws and policy accordingly. I want a church that loves so radically that we are always putting up chairs to make room for more, always leaving empty chairs at the table, expecting that many more will come and turning no one away. I want a church that loves so generously that our priority will be the elimination of poverty to ensure that everyone has enough to eat, safe and decent housing, health care, a living wage, and quality education that is not based on your zip code. I want a church that loves so creatively that we are willing to dismantle structures, traditions, and processes that dishonor humanity and marginalize any among us. I want a church that loves so completely we are not satisfied until justice rolls down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. I want a church that follows Jesus and is therefore committed to work for all of this. Let's get to work, church. If we dare to be those disciples of the Pentecost church, it means crossing borders, crossing boundaries, crossing picket lines, and being present as the body of Christ beyond these walls, beyond the walls we have created within our own hearts, knowingly or unknowingly, and reaching to the ends of the earth as we have been called. Let us go and be the church. May God light a fire in us again to do so. Amen. On the final night that Jesus gathered with his friends, he took bread, and after he had blessed it, he broke it, and he offered it to them, explaining that this was his body, that there might be no more broken bodies, but broken for them, that we might have salvation. In the same way, he took the cup and offered it to them, explaining that this is the cup of the new covenant for the forgiveness of sins, that all might be welcome in the kingdom of God. Friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God, whether you are using bread and wine or gummy bears and fruit juice, or whatever you have in your home. God blesses us wherever we are. And there is nowhere we can go where God's love and grace cannot reach us. So let us join in this sacred time of communion, of coming together by sharing in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. May this bread and this cup feed and nourish your body as we share in this time of communion and as we go forth to be the church.
Why are there so many songs about rainbows? And what's on the other side? Rainbows are visions, but only illusions, and rainbows have nothing to hide. So we've been told, and some choose to believe it. I know they're wrong, wait and see. Someday we'll find it, the rainbow connection, the lovers, the dreamers, and me. Who said that every wish would be heard and answered when wished on the morning star? Somebody thought of that, and someone believed it. Look what it's done so far. What's so amazing that keeps us stargazing? And what do we think we might see? Someday we'll find it, the rainbow connection, the lovers, the dreamers, and me. All of us under its spell, we know that it's probably magic. Have you been half asleep? heard them calling my name. Is this the sweet sound that calls the young sailors? The voice might be one and the same. I've heard it too many times to ignore it. It's something that I'm supposed to be. Someday we'll find it, the rainbow connection, the lovers, the dreamers, and me.
So may we end with prayers of good courage and songs of thanksgiving, going forth knowing that our offerings come not only in the form of prayer, but in acts of service and justice and kindness. Will you pray with me? Lord God, you have called your servants to ventures of which we cannot see the ending, by paths as yet untrodden, through perils unknown. Give us faith to go out or to stay in with good courage, not knowing where we go, but only that your hand is leading us and your love supporting us. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Be well.